Welcome to Ideas in Action, the official University of Southern California podcast. This program was recorded live on campus as part of Visions and Voices, the USC Arts and Humanities Initiative.
I'm going to start by introducing Evan Kleiman. For many of us, reading Eric's book, Fast Food Nation, was the first time we were actually called upon to think about what we ate. And I really feel that if a book could be said to start a movement, then Fast Food Nation definitely did. It's really fitting that the book was written by this passionate investigative journalist. He followed the story into pesticide-filled fields and really gross meatpacking plants. Published 10 years ago last month, Fast Food Nation was in great part Eric's attempt to shed light on worlds that tend to remain hidden. So I think it's kind of fitting that the documentary that you saw the trailer of, Fast Food, Food Inc., which he co-produced, had the effect of shining sort of Klieg lights on this part of this food system that was hidden from a lot of people in the public. Eric has an interesting and varied creative life. He was the executive producer of the feature film of his book, Fast Food Nation, and he co-wrote the critically acclaimed screenplay. And in the non-food arena, Eric was an executive producer of the Paul Thomas Anderson movie, There Will Be Blood. He continues to be an activist in the food movement he helped create. For almost a decade, Eric's been researching a book on the American prison system, and his next book, Command and Control, is about nuclear weapons. So great to get to talk with you. And now Michael. My introduction to Michael Pollan's writing was a feature article he wrote for Harper's Magazine in 1997, many years ago. He was executive editor of Harper's. The article was about poppies and opium, the plant and the drug. And I felt as if I were reading for the first time a point of view that included society, horticulturalists, DEA agents, me, and the plant. I felt as if it just went by in a moment. It was 10 pages, and it felt like it was a couple of paragraphs. Then he resurfaced for me again in the breakthrough New York Times Magazine cover article in which Michael bought a calf and then followed it through the industrial food system and wrote about it. It was a truly breakthrough article. In addition to writing, Pollan teaches. He's the John S. and James L. Knight Professor of Journalism at UC Berkeley's Graduate School of Journalism and the director of the Knight Program in Science and Environmental Journalism. Wouldn't I like to be part of that program? And in addition to teaching, he lectures widely on food, agriculture, and gardening. But precisely because Michael is so interested in exploring the places where the human and the natural worlds intersect, he seems to be able to create an astonishing, elegant clarity of subjects that are some of the most complex of our time. His books you've probably read, and if not, you should, are The Botany of Desire, An Omnivore's Dilemma in Defense of Food, and Eater's Manifesto, and his very handy Manuals for Eaters, Food Rules, which gave us the best food mantra ever: eat food, not too much, mostly plants.
Thank you, Evan.
Well, it's wonderful to have the two of you here together in this very rare conversation. So let's just jump right in. Eric, because it's a decade since you published your book, Fast Food Nation, can you go back in time and give us a little snapshot of what the food landscape was like then, the sort of egregious horrors that struck you the most?
You know, I really started investigating the fast food industry in the late 90s. It was 1997 that I took an assignment from Rolling Stone. And the industry really seemed like it was going to grow and grow, and that mentality of uniformity and conformity and control and, you know, processing being the ideal was just going to continue. And in the last decade, things have really been transformed in a certain segment of society. I mean, we now have a food movement, and we now have, you know, incredible writing on sustainability. And I think the food movement is the real social movement of today on college campuses. But 14 years ago, that wasn't the case. And I don't really have any expertise in food, and I was remarkably ignorant about it. And for me, I was just constantly amazed at what I was learning about the food that I was eating, and that's what the story behind Fast Food Nation was just kind of this feeling that the truth was being deliberately hidden from us and that the reality was appalling. And so that's a decade, that's 14 years ago.
So Michael, we now jump forward 10 years from when the book was published. A different landscape? Just speaking from the point of view of food itself, not necessarily the movement yet, the way it's produced.
No, amazing things have not changed. And we shouldn't, you know, exaggerate how much has actually been achieved in the industrial food system. But now we have another food system. I mean, I think what we have are two different food systems. And that's an encouraging thing, but also troubling because, you know, one of them is less accessible than the other. But I mean, there have been some small reforms, I think, since Fast Food Nation. You know, you've had McDonald's has made their slaughter practices somewhat more humane than they were. And what else? Do you think of anything else?
Well, wait. They have apple slices that you can dip in caramel.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And they figured out how to make a salad that actually has more calories than a Big Mac.
That's an impressive achievement of food science.
It's not easy to cram that many calories, and as a cook, you know this, into a salad.
I do think that that what we have now, which we didn't have 14 years ago, is we have essentially two food systems. And we have one food system now that's increasingly feeding the upper middle class and the wealthy. And then we have the same industrial fast food system that's, you know, serving the vast majority of Americans. And it's almost like a science fiction film in the sense that the well-to-do and the well-educated are eating incredibly good food and fit as can be with their personal trainers. And the vast majority of Americans are being made seriously unhealthy. And you can almost, you know, trace and plot obesity by level of education and level of income. But I'm optimistic in the sense that, you know, I feel like this movement is going to grow and expand, and it didn't really exist 14 years ago. There had been, during the 60s and 70s, this great food movement that I was largely ignorant of, with pioneers like Wendell Berry and Alice Waters, and yet, you know, by the 90s, it seemed to have fallen out of the mass consciousness.
So this is sort of an extraordinary week of things that have happened in which to be having this conversation. Let's talk for a minute about the new dietary guidelines that were just released. Michael, do you want to take us there?
Yeah, well, there have been a lot of very interesting food stories, and I think that's part of the change that Eric's describing, a level of consciousness. You have the First Lady, obviously, devoting a lot of her time and energy and reputation to this issue, and that's very encouraging, and that's one of the reasons that the government was under a great deal of pressure to issue, every 5 years they issue dietary guidelines, and to revise these in a way that would deal with the problem of obesity and diabetes. And they made some progress. They actually say people should eat less food.
Which is the first time
which
ever.
Which is more radical than it sounds, because the government has since 1977 been effectively prohibited from ever putting the word less next to any food product. And so that is encouraging. But when you dig down a little deeper, the usual compromises have been made. One of the bloggers who is writing about it, Marian Nessel, who's very good on these subjects, points out that when they're talking about foods you should eat more of, like fruits and vegetables, they use the words, recognizable words, fruits, vegetables. But as soon as they get to the things you should eat less of, they revert to the language of nutrients. And they start talking about, now they're obsessed with solid fats and added sugars, a new acronym called SOFAs.
SOFAs.
So they can't bring themselves to say, eat less of any recognizable food, still. And indeed, even the First Lady, you know, who spoke this morning on the Today Show, I was very struck by her inability to mouth the words, say she was talking about sweetened drinks. And rather than say, drink less soda, all she could say was, drink more water. It's not quite the same thing.
So this brings me to the question, it's almost as if the individual is pitted against, not almost, it is, the individual is pitted against the corporation, and does it then become a civil rights issue between someone's individual right to lead a healthy life versus the American corporation desire for free and fettered speech?
Well, we're on our way to giving full First Amendment rights to corporations. And in fact, there's a suit winding its way through the courts, or will be. After, you know, this year the FDA cracked down on a lot of the really bogus health claims that are commonly made on products. You know, cereals that improve your children's focus. There are, or that will prevent swine flu, or a fruit juice that will cure erectile dysfunction. This was one that was out there. Pomegranate juice, in case you want to know.
Just in case.
But in fact, the maker of the pomegranate juice is going to court, challenging the FDA's ability to restrict their right to say whatever they want about their pomegranate juice. And with this Supreme Court, this could well prevail.
Do you feel like, well, the USDA plays these two sort of combative roles with itself. One, it's supposed to look out for the nutritional well-being of citizens of the country, and the other, it's a marketer.
You should address that.
I mean, it's also responsible for the food safety of our meat, and yet is, you know, its real goal, and most of its money is spent promoting American agricultural products. And there is an enormous inherent contradiction between the, you know, the desire for healthy nutrition and the desire for safe food and the way in which they promote food. So, you know, a logical system would separate out the nutritional aspects and the food safety aspects from the USDA.
Let's talk about the Food Safety Modernization Act for a minute, because when I did a shout out on Facebook and Twitter saying that I was going to be interviewing the two of you, and I asked what would you most like to ask these two gentlemen, many people wanted to know why you both, in their view, caved and supported it.
Well, I know that I think the idea of anyone growing their own food in the backyard is terrible, and this law is going to prevent people from growing their own food. I mean, there was the most insane, bizarre disinformation spread about this act, and I don't think it was accidental and coincidental, and I don't want to mention which companies may have been responsible because I'm very well versed with the libel laws of this country, but it was interesting to me that the meatpacking industry, for example, fought tooth and nail against FDA modernization, even though the FDA bill would not have regulated any of their products. And it was interesting when one of the great thinkers of this country, when Glenn Beck opposed the bill, Glenn Beck argued, and he was quite excited about it, that it was going to make meat so expensive that it was a secret plot to make Americans vegetarian. So the amount of misinformation, disinformation, and outright lying was extraordinary. I can't speak for Michael, but I supported this bill because for the first time it would give the FDA the power to take dangerous and contaminated food off of the marketplace. For the first time it would impose, you know, really rigorous testing standards for dangerous pathogens on companies, and it would allow the government to penalize companies that knowingly shipped contaminated food. And because of Senator Tester from Montana, there was a very good loophole put into it to protect small producers. And, you know, this was far from being radical legislation. And the notion that anyone could oppose it the way that it was opposed was totally due I felt, to the lies that were being spread by some big industry groups using Tea Party types as their mouthpieces.
I'm surprised you said you couldn't speak for me. Didn't we co-sign an op-ed piece about this?
Yeah.
Well, I think we spoke for each other. I supported the bill because I thought that there were sufficient protections. There's a tension, no question, between what needs to be done to control the perils of a industrialized food system and the fact that you have small farmers who can't afford to deal with a lot of regulations. There is risk, in small farms too. It's not to say that small farms are by nature going to be absolutely free of pathogens. We've learned, in fact, there have been several small cheesemakers who have been closed down because it turned out that they were dealing with food safety problems. However, there is I think the protections built into the bill will allow them to go about their business, and those problems will occur, but they won't be on the scale of the kinds of outbreaks that we've seen that have sickened thousands of people over state lines. So I understand, and I'm sympathetic too. There was a lot of disinformation. I'm sympathetic to the concerns of small farmers who are worried about this. On the other hand, they have responsibilities too to keep their food clean. And so I think we've struck a balance here. I don't know that I could have supported the bill without the Tester Amendment. And I think Senator Tester proved himself a great friend of the food movement by working so hard to carve out those exemptions. Basically, what it provides for is if a farm is selling locally within 175 miles, 275
maybe
miles?
250, maybe.
250, and is selling less than $500,000 worth of produce, it doesn't come under the law. It's under local and state law. And I think that's good. There is this strong libertarian strain in the food movement among small farmers who really feel, and they make the case. Joel Salatin is a great example, who you saw in that trailer. He says, wait a minute, you have a Second Amendment right to bear arms, but you don't have a right to buy raw milk, from your neighbor. And, I'd quibble about whether, in fact, individuals have a Second Amendment right to bear arms. But, I see that. I see that argument. And I think people should be able to buy raw milk. But we also need to assure its safety. So it's a point of tension. And the way of politics is that compromises are made. And I think that this was really a good one. I think that now the challenge is to move this way of thinking over to meat, which remains very poorly regulated. And the hope is that this was the template, and I think this is why the meat guys got involved in this fight, that this was the template of a system you could do with meat. As soon as the Tester Amendment was introduced, by the way, the industry backed off a bill that they had supported. Yeah. They ran away from it as quickly as they could. Not all of it, but the growers did, and the meat industry did.
Before we came on, we were talking a little bit about the new Walmart initiative to take smaller margins and lower the prices of produce so more people could afford more produce. Do you believe that's actually going to happen, or do you think they're going to grind the little farmer who is already struggling to deliver for less money?
Well, Walmart's made several different initiatives, and that's one of them, to make produce cheaper. And they say that they're going to do this by working with their growers to improve their efficiencies. Their history says that they will crush their growers. this is their pattern. They buy a lot of stuff from you, you gear up your production, they become your main source of income, and then they come back to you and say, next year, we want you to cut your prices 20%. And you don't have any choice because you've geared up your whole business to do this. They've promised that this is not how they're going to operate in this case, and we'll have to see. I mean, I think one of the big challenges is going to be to monitor the commitments they made to the First Lady. And I don't know what sort of enforcement device The other thing they agreed to do was reprocess all their own brand packaged foods, reducing the sodium by 25%, reducing trans fats, eliminating trans fats, and other things. We'll see. You know, they said it's going to take them 5 years. I don't know. I can take the salt out of a dish in a lot less than 5 years. I don't know why it's going to take quite that long, but maybe it's a bigger food science challenge than I realize. But the thing that Walmart has done, and I'm really curious to get Eric's take on this, they are the biggest grocer in the country. They basically feed, 40% or so of the public their groceries. And all at the bottom of the socioeconomic scale, right? People earning $20,000 to $30,000 a year are getting all their food at Walmart in America. And this is the group that's suffering disproportionately from obesity and diabetes. They have a lot of power, and they have claimed that they're going to use this power to mitigate some of these problems. I think the most interesting and hopeful initiative of theirs is this one to re-regionalize their supply chain for food. And this was announced last month. It got a lot less attention. But I think it's the interesting one to watch, because I don't think marginally improving processed food really makes a difference. Slightly better packaged food. We had that. That was called the low-fat campaign beginning in the 1980s, where we took all the fat out of the food and the obesity epidemic got worse. So that doesn't work. And I think it's a waste of energy to be negotiating, improved cookies and crackers, which is what we're talking about. But they have said that they're going to try to work with smaller, more regional growers. And the reason they want to do this is their self-interest, which is to say they want to use less fossil fuel. As many other parts of the industry, in 2008, when we had that big spike in fossil fuel prices, their costs went up dramatically because they were shipping produce from California all over the country. And they decided they want to figure out if they can supply broccoli and carrots on the eastern seaboard, grown on the eastern seaboard. And they're going to buy from local farmers, not local like at your farmer's market, but regional growers, and help them diversify their crops. And they're going to have a program to work with them. And I think that could be significant if they can figure out how to do it profitably. Because the problem with a big institution engaging with little vendors is that the transaction costs are really expensive. It's much easier to have one contract to buy all your carrots from one grower in California than to have 50 contracts.
How frightening is it that one grower is growing for the entire country?
Yeah, it's crazy. But, this is a very brittle system. And for their own interests, they're trying to make it more resilient. So, whenever I sort of invest any kind of hope in companies like Walmart solving problems, part of me thinks, isn't that sad that this is what it takes? That they can move in a way the government will not be able to move. But we saw that with McDonald's. When McDonald's decides to make changes under pressure, whether it's to change their slaughter practices or to stop selling genetically modified potatoes, which they also did, one company can change the whole landscape. And Walmart could change the whole landscape. So I think engaging with them and pushing them is worthwhile. What do you think?
I think that their environmental initiatives are sincere. And I think they really are taking a leadership in corporate America and a lot of sustainability initiatives. I think that some of their sustainable and regional agricultural initiatives may also be sincere. I think some of the Walton family members themselves are believers in healthier food. The real problem is there shouldn't be any corporation in this country that powerful. And during the Eisenhower administration, which was a conservative, Republican, pro-business administration, Walmart would have been broken up under antitrust law. Eisenhower took on the oil companies. He took on the supermarket chains like A&P, which had much less market power than Walmart. And this sort of unchecked corporate power is completely contrary to a democracy. So I feel that if they're going to have Well, if they're going to have that much power, I applaud them for doing good things with it when they do. It might be good if they paid a living wage to their workers, allowed labor unions, and maybe, you know, improve their healthcare plan. But I'm willing to give them credit for some of these things. And, you know, as Michael said, I think we're really going to need to see how it all plays out. But, you know, I recently went online and Walmart and ExxonMobil every year compete to see who have the largest annual revenues. And Walmart's annual revenues are up to something like $425 billion a year, which is much larger than many nation states. And one of the things that is so amazing to me about the Tea Party movement is how they've persuaded all these people who are under great financial pressure to be anti-government and not anti-corporate. And the power of Walmart and the power of Monsanto and the power of Cargill and ConAgra is so enormous that when we look at any of the policies coming out of Washington, you know, what's being protested against as this kind of anti-government movement is really, you know, anti, you know, the corporations who are behind the scenes pulling so many of the strings. So, you know, for me, a lot of what Fast Food Nation was really about was about, you know, how, you know, a handful of corporations have essentially taken over our food supply. And you can look at just about every other industry and see the same thing.
And what is it, what kind of denial is it, do you think, that causes people to not internalize that?
I think it's extremely clever marketing. And, you know, the only, and I'm not a socialist. And I'm not a lover of government regulations, but when you see an entity like Walmart or ExxonMobil, the only possible counterweight against their power is the government. And it's no coincidence that Mr. Koch and his brother, who are the funders of the Tea Party, have oil and gas interests that really don't want any kind of government interference with their business. And so there's an incredible amount of disinformation, again, and misinformation, and people being persuaded to act against their own interests, which is so much of the history of the last 30 years.
Well, and let me add to that, too. Where would that consciousness come from? I mean, the way our system works, you would need prominent politicians telling a story about how power functions in this country. And that's not happening because of the freedom of corporations to buy politicians. And so that's where you would, I mean, you don't have a debate in America unless you've got one of the political parties on the other side. And we have had since the mid-1970s both political parties very closely allied with big business. And the story of Monsanto is a classic example. This is a company that in a very far-sighted way romanced the Democratic Party in the 80s and 90s and has powerful friends on both sides of the aisle. And so there's no debate in Congress about genetic engineering. So you don't get debate over these issues unless you have political diversity, and we don't. On the subject of corporations, we have a monoculture. And so that's part of it. And we also, with the rise of the Tea Party, we also had a president, I think, who failed to tell a story about corporate power at a time when it was an enormous crisis, and he had a terrific opportunity right after the financial crisis. And for reasons that are obscure to me, declined to have this conversation. Declined even to tell the story of the financial crisis.
It's not a simple anti-corporate issue. Ultimately, it's about power and unchecked power and how corrupting it is. And that's a very, very old story, whether it's religious power, whether it's unchecked political power. And, you know, the scale and size and influence of these corporations is the greatest, if not greater, than it's been since the 1890s. And it's not good for a democratic society. I mean, I keep on coming back to Glenn Beck and these guys. I got to get them out of my mind. But, I mean, you know, the genius of the founding fathers in setting up our political system was to ensure competing centers of power. And we're increasingly lacking that in the economic sphere. And, you know, I hate to be singing the praises of former Republican presidents, but this is something that Teddy Roosevelt understood quite well and, you know, really launched a movement for antitrust. And if you believe in the free market and you believe in capitalism, you need competing forces. You need competing corporations. And when you have companies like Monsanto and DuPont, you know, essentially taking over the seed stock of the United States, that's just completely antithetical to competition. I mean, hundreds of small seed companies are vanishing. And when you think about, well, who do I want responsible for the seeds that are the basic source of all of our food? Is it the manufacturers of Agent Orange? You know, it just doesn't make sense that companies that for decades have produced some of the most toxic substances and released them into our environment should now have control over our food.
I want to go back to Monsanto in a minute, but I'm very curious, this idea of regionality. Is no one, as far as you know, in the Defense Department, for example, thinking about the fact that our long chain supply system of food has so little redundancy regionally that a blow could be struck against it? It seems like it would be an issue of security to keep it more local.
That conversation reared its head for about 2 minutes after 9/11. And in fact, it was Tommy Thompson, who was the, at the time, I don't know if he was at Health and Human Services or at Homeland Security.
That's right.
Who said that there was, when they were reviewing all the possible threats to security, pointed to the fact of an over-centralized food system as a terrific threat to our national security.
Because of bioterrorism.
Because of the threat, yeah, because if you could introduce a microbe into one hamburger grinding plant, you could sicken 50,000 people in a week.
And oddly enough, the Department of Defense are huge supporters of Michelle Obama's, you know, fitness program because they're really worried about recruits. And the proportion of their recruits who are disqualified for being obese or overweight is huge. So
27% of their age group of 18 to 24 are too obese to meet their standards for recruitment, and they've had to lower those standards, in fact. So they're very interested in reforming the American diet right now in the White House. But anyway, after Tommy Thompson raised this issue, it just went away. It was just way too hot a thing to raise. But there is a national security threat in having an overly centralized food system, and there's a political threat too. You know, antitrust, we have laws that should prohibit these kind of combinations. In fact, there are only four meat packers controlling more than 85%, right, of all the beef slaughtered in this country, just four companies. But under the Reagan administration, the rules for antitrust were rewritten in the Justice Department. And basically, they were changed in such a way that if you couldn't prove that combination was raising prices and therefore hurting consumers, there was no problem with it. Now, that was not what we had antitrust for, to protect consumers from high prices. We had it to protect the political system from concentrations of political power. And the Reagan Justice Department changed that definition. And it was not a change in legislation, by the way. Any Justice Department could change it back. And the fact is, the combination in food has not, except for the Monsanto case, but in the case of meat and many other things, led to high prices. In fact, it's often led to low prices.
At what cost, though?
Cost to the producers, cost to the environment, cost to the public health.
Now, this is something that I've always found to me, it's my biggest conundrum. You see Food Inc. and the scene that most people just cannot get over and cannot forget is the ammoniated ground beef scene. This semi meat being ground up and reformed and then, of course, being dumped into school nutrition lunches. Why don't people rise up? Why doesn't every community just refuse, like bar those trucks from bringing that meat into elementary schools?
I don't think many people know about it. I don't think most of this audience knows what you're talking about. This is something called, in the industry, pink slime, which is added to 80 or 90% of our hamburgers. It's a product made from the scraps that used to be fed to dogs and now are...
Careful, Michael.
Separated by centrifuge, and
we have a lot of libel experience.
treated with ammonia, and then added to ground beef as a cheap filler.
Is there labeling?
No, it's not an additive. Even though ammonia is being added, it still says pure ground beef, and that's a question because the ammonia is an adulterant. But we're supposed to be happy for the ammonia because it kills the E. coli in the rest of the meat. It's a really disgusting product, and the fact that we're all eating it is hard to believe.
Having this enormous experiment of having millions of school children eating it because they're 77 cents a day can only purchase.
And it also comes back to what you were saying before about the USDA and its conflicted obligations. I mean, the National School Lunch Program was created when there was real concern about, you know, poor nutrition and starvation and malnutrition among American children. And it was, over the years, transferred and transformed into being a place where the worst, lousiest commodities that industry couldn't sell anywhere else could just sell to the government and dump, you know, onto school children's plates. Some of the most disgusting stuff that, you know, has been sold recently were these spent hens who, you know, had been laying eggs, you know, so much that they were so scrawny and so antibiotic ridden that even the fast food chains would not buy the meat from spent hens because it just was considered inferior. So what happened to it? Well, there was a USA Today expose, I think last year, that showed about how much of it was being bought by the federal government and then what, you know, sold to, you know, sent to schools. I mean, just appalling. And I want to mention that was probably one of my favorite scenes in Food Inc. as well, that bizarre hamburger filler factory that seems like something out of The Matrix. And the director of Food Inc. is in here somewhere tonight, and he is to be applauded not only for going into that factory, his name is Robbie Kenner, but for actually tasting some of the stuff, which I think he was dared in the moment to do it, and because he's such a nice and polite guy, actually did it. I have no idea what's going to happen to him 15 years from now as a result, but he's had it at the source.
Do you think that these companies, particularly the meat companies, feel like they own that 77 cents that's supposed to go to children?
Well, that's what they're using the program for. It is a disposal system for surplus agricultural commodities that you can't sell on the market. And, you know, hopefully this will change. I mean, there was new legislation passed this year that improved the standards for school lunch, child nutrition reauthorization program. And this was something that Michelle Obama worked very hard to get through Congress, and it wasn't easy. And even though it's underfunded, it does have, you know, much higher nutritional standards than we've seen. It will get soda out of the schools. It will get a lot of junk food out of the schools, and that's a very good thing. Whether it'll stop, you know, spent hens from getting into the chicken nuggets, I don't know. But I'm hopeful.
Let's go back to Monsanto, who is now allowed to sell GMO alfalfa. Well, we don't eat alfalfa. Why should we care?
That's a good question. When I tried to get television networks interested in doing the story 2 weeks ago when it was deregulated, that's what they said. Well, who eats alfalfa? You know, unless you have a horse, it's not of concern. But of course, alfalfa is the important feed for cattle, both dairy and meat, and it is what the government did was deregulate, allow to be sold without restriction, genetically modified alfalfa. It's been modified to withstand Roundup, which is a herbicide that's sold by Monsanto. And the thing that has mystified me about this decision, because it is the threat is to the organic industry. If you're selling organic milk or organic meat, you must certify that your animals have eaten only organic grain or grass. And the alfalfa will be contaminated, essentially, because of the way that it pollinates. It'll be very hard to find GMO-free hay for your animals.
Because there's such a thing called drift.
Yeah, it's called, it's genetic drift.
And because alfalfa is a perennial, which means once it's out there growing, it's out there growing, as opposed to the corn and the soy, you know, which they've been planting for years, but they had to, you know, plant a whole new seeds every year. But this alfalfa, once it's out there, it's out there. It's going to be very hard to control. And I think, and I'm going to shut up and let Michael finish, I think that this was important to the industry because getting a perennial out there is a kind of a foothold in getting anything else out there they want to get out there.
But the weird, so there's a risk. There's a clear risk to organic agriculture, and the government knows it. The thing I don't get is that, according to the USDA's own numbers, 93% of the alfalfa crop is grown without any herbicides at all.
Because it's a very robust
it's
plant.
It's a grass. It you know, you don't, once you get a stand established, there are very few weeds in it. And what few there are, is you can still sell them. And so it is a lousy solution to a non-existent problem. And I say it's a lousy solution because Roundup isn't working very well anymore also. It's soon to be obsolete. We're getting these weeds that are resistant to Roundup. And now in the Midwest, you know, the story of big industrial farmers is that they've got their fancy equipment and they drive on tractors all day while the organic guys have to hand hoe and everything, and they would look down on them. Well, now the big corn and soy farmers are out there with machetes cutting weeds that the Roundup won't take care of. They're pigweeds taller than I am now that are resistant to this thing. So I'm somewhat mystified as to whether anyone will actually buy this product, but Monsanto is out there selling it really hard, and they were terrified, I think, of the original deal on offer. Tom Vilsack, the agricultural secretary, was trying to work out a compromise, a coexistence plan, where if you were going to plant the Roundup Ready alfalfa, you had to be a certain distance from organic fields, and they were going to protect organic farmers because it would hurt their business. And he had, reportedly, he had signed off on this compromise, and but was overruled by the White House. Because essentially Monsanto, which has, you know, many people in our government through the revolving door, this was too big a threat. This would have been an enormous precedent, and it would have been a challenge to all their products, that they were responsible in some sense for contaminating others. And one of the great injustices of organic is, legally, if Monsanto's genes are found in your farm, you're liable as if you had stolen their seeds, and you have to pay them. And many, many farmers have been forced to pay, even for accidental contaminations. But when the shoe is on the other foot, and their genes contaminate your field and you don't want them, they have no liability at all, which seems deeply unfair. So anyway, this was not a proud moment, I don't think, of the Obama administration to let this pass. But it will be tied up in the courts for a long time, and there are many grounds to fight it legally. And the Center for Food Safety is carrying that torch, and will be in court very soon about this.
So let's talk about.
Can we talk about something more positive?
Let's talk about feeding the world.
You didn't hear me. Well, what about it? I'm in favor.
Yeah, I'm in favor. I'm sure you hear all the time, how can we feed the world if a system exists that Michael Pollan would approve of?
Well, a couple of things about that. It's very important to remember that we're not feeding the world with the system we have. that industrial agriculture has failed that challenge, and that there are a billion or so people right now who don't have enough to eat. And that there are many countries that have gone down the industrial path, have grain silos bulging with grain and hungry people living within yards of those silos. I mean, the hunger problem has a lot to do with food access, not yield. We have enough food now to feed just what we're growing this year. Even with high food prices, even with all the problems we have enough food to feed about 10 to 11 billion people being grown right now.
Worldwide?
Worldwide. The fact is we're feeding about half of it to animals, and that the way we cannot feed the world probably is on an American-style meat diet. That is true. You cannot feed the world 8 or 9 ounces of animal protein a day, as the average American eats. But there is plenty of food, and there will be plenty of food. The argument to feed the world has been used to convince American farmers to overproduce for decades and decades and decades. That we've got to grow enough food, because there was otherwise no way to justify to them the rationality of growing more food than you could sell and declining prices that resulted. So the ethos of ever-increasing yield that has been sold to us has led to all sorts of problems, including overnutrition. I mean, we have a billion who are hungry, we have a billion who are obese. So could you feed the world on organic food? Is that the question, or sustainable food?
Let's say sustainable food.
I mean, the honest answer is we don't know, but we have managed to solve, in many cases, we know that an acre of land or 5 acres of land can produce vast amounts more food than it does in the developing world right now, or even than it does in Iowa right now. If the world went organic, world yields would go up about, I don't have the numbers at hand, but it's 40 or 50%.
Have there ever been any modeling studies to take a look at what would happen to either yield or environmental impacts if a more sustainable system could be magically implemented worldwide?
There have been different studies, and I just want to weigh in and, you know, the argument today is being made by Monsanto and the genetically modified food / chemical companies, who argue against the organic movement by saying, basically, if you support organics, you support poor people starving throughout the world. And you just have to be a little bit suspicious of this argument, because they have not proven that their genetically modified plants have higher yields. They've only proven that it allows you to use more pesticide, and therefore it allows these companies to sell more pesticide. And, you know, the statistic that Michael was talking about 50% of the food going to animals, in the United States, it's over 75% of the food that we produce is being fed to livestock. And of the food that's produced for human consumption, about half of it is thrown away. So roughly, of the food being produced in the United States, maybe 12, 14% is actually being eaten by people. And there's a professor at Cornell who did a calculation. If we stopped devoting so much of our production, over 75%, you know, and feeding it to livestock so that they get fat, and we fed people instead on a more plant-based diet, I mean, just the United States alone could feed about 1 billion to 1.5 billion more people. So it's just absurd to argue that the system that Michael, and particularly, argues on behalf of today, and what his work is so much about, it's absurd to argue that that system's not sustainable. It's the current industrial chemical model that's not sustainable and is already causing unbelievable harm to people's bodies and the planet. But again, it's just a remarkable form of misinformation and distortion with these companies whose products have not yet proven themselves, arguing that their products are the only possible solution, and if you oppose them, you know, you support starving babies in third world countries.
Another point, I completely agree with that, is that First of all, well, there's a lot of points to this, but overproducing in America, producing huge amounts of grain to feed the world, leads to hunger. And this sounds counterintuitive, but when we dump subsidized grain on Africa, we bankrupt African farmers. And so just because we grow it doesn't mean it's being fed to anyone in the developing world. And in fact, we are now using about 20% of our corn crop to feed our cars. And anyone who's really concerned about feeding the world should have a real problem with using corn to make ethanol, which is responsible for the spike in food prices around the world. It's one of the main factors. So you have to really scrutinize these arguments carefully. And what Eric said about Monsanto and their products, the evidence is that they have not increased yield. And I think most people assume that, oh, GMOs, they must be more productive. That's not what they do. They essentially they do not improve yield except under very narrow circumstances. Corn under bad European corn borer years will do better. But soy, much worse, and down the line. What they do is allow farmers to get bigger and take care of more land. Basically, that's what a Monsanto product does so far. It allows you to grow a larger field because you don't have to worry about a little outbreak of pests over there because your plants are exuding pesticide 24/7. So it's what Monsanto is doing thus far. Now, maybe they will come up with a product that actually contributes to feeding the world. Maybe. And I'm open to that possibility, but they haven't done that yet. What they've done is come up with products that allow American farmers to expand their monocultures.
Okay, let's turn to something more positive.
Yeah.
Let's look at what everybody in the audience can be doing. Let's look at leverage, because system changes through leverage applied on very specific pressure points. If you could choose three fights, food fights that are not ambiguous, what would they be around which people could easily make the decision to apply pressure?
Well, I'll throw out one to start. I think banning important human antibiotics in livestock production would be very important in a lot of ways. I think we have an enormous problem with antibiotic-resistant pathogens in the food system. New diseases that are coming off of our CAFOs, our feedlots and confinement operations. And 70% of antibiotics are going to keep animals alive and promote their growth in these really brutal systems. If you ban those antibiotics, you would have to do other things to clean up that system, because basically the reason you'd have to give animals more space. You'd have to give them more daylight. You'd have to give them more grass. You'd have to have cleaner animal raising facilities. So I think a lot would change with that one change, which can be justified very easily on public health grounds. So that's one. What do you have?
I'll give one that's food related and one that's general. Access to healthy food for all Americans. And by making sure that school lunches and low-income communities have access to healthy food, fundamentally. And it connects to my second point, which is the biggest impediment to changing our food system is apathy. And when you look at how social change occurs, and you look at incredibly abusive systems that were overturned, far more oppressive systems than our current food system were changed and reformed and overturned. And there's absolutely no reason why we have to tolerate this system, and there's no reason why it has to continue. So I think that there is a kind of we're talking about four meatpacking companies. We're talking about three or four chemical/seed companies. We're talking about three or four major grain companies, and we're talking about 300 million Americans. And there is so much more freedom of expression, freedom of organization, freedom of action here still, despite this corporate power. But what they're I think has been for the last 20 years is just an incredible amount of apathy, a culture of kind of irony and cynicism, and a lack of faith in the belief that you can really change things. And compared to other sorts of dictatorships that have been toppled, this is nothing. So I think that, you know, what people in this audience should know is that this can be changed if you really care about doing it and you want to spend some time actively doing it. But none of these problems were inevitable. And despite this incredible corporate power, all of these corporations are vulnerable in one way or another, either to regulation or to people not buying their products, et cetera, et cetera.
And I'd add one other thing, too. As a place to get involved, to really intervene, next year we're going to have a big discussion about the Farm Bill. Every 5 years, we have this piece of legislation, which is really the rule that sets the rules of the game for this entire system. It is decided by very few farm state legislators with very little attention from anyone else, with the result that the bill codifies things like tremendous subsidies for precisely the wrong kind of crops. We subsidize junk food, corn and soy, which are the building blocks of fast food, to the tune of about $20 billion a year, even in years when agricultural prices are very high, as they are right now. The bill is designed as a special interest piece of legislation, but it should be about us. I mean, the farm bill needs to be a food bill. It needs to have the interests of eaters represented. And it is only because we're not paying attention, especially those of us in cities, that urban legislators are not paying attention, that they give away their vote, essentially, because no one's paying attention to the farm bill. And it is the most, if we could change that, if we could change the subsidy system, we would begin to make healthy food more competitive with junk food. We would begin to solve these problems without relying on the benevolence of corporations like Walmart.
The last round of the food bill saw probably more activism expressed than ever before. Do you think that it will be an order of magnitude this time?
Yeah. They were shocked last time. Nancy Pelosi in particular was shocked because she got behind a really lousy bill, hoping to protect some freshman legislators. Didn't work out very well. They're all gone. But the amount of political attention, the San Francisco Chronicle in her hometown ran farm bill stories twice on their cover that summer when it was being debated. So I think this time you're going to see even more people involved writing letters, lobbying their congressmen. Will we get radical change this time around? Probably not, but it's an incremental process. I mean, we won't have radical change till we actually have a different kind of legislator sitting on these committees, people who are interested in health, people who are interested in the environment, and not just people interested in sending pork back to Iowa.
Wouldn't it be great if they all had to wear NASCAR jackets?
One of the great ironies, too, is that, you know, if you look at the anti-government movement right now, some of its most powerful bases of support are in these states that are getting billions of dollars in direct subsidies, you know, through our farm subsidy program. I mean, in the last decade, about $150 to $160 billion has been given to farmers in the form of subsidies. And, you know, overwhelmingly, 75% of it to the top 10% big farmers. And yet these same states are against, you know, health insurance for the poor, are against any kind of, you know, welfare payments for people in the inner city, and yet don't see the contradiction of sometimes having as much as 40 to 50% of the annual income of their farmers being handouts from the government, basically, to grow the wrong sorts of food. So there is this huge contradiction that I hope will be made much more clear as the next farm bill is being debated. And I don't oppose all subsidies to farmers, but at the same time, they shouldn't be subsidized to, you know, be producing cheap feed for livestock and cheap corn for, you know, corn sweeteners.
Well, so much of what we think of as food isn't what is being subsidized. I mean, what we think of as food is called specialty crops.
Right. Yeah, isn't that ironic?
Totally ironic.
If you can eat it, it's a specialty crop. No, all the corn and soy that were, you can't eat that corn and you can't eat that soy. Those are very, that's animal feed or the feedstock for hydrogenated fats or high fructose corn syrup. That is not food, but that is what we subsidize.
And do you think that the majority of people don't understand that? So when they hear that we're subsidizing farmers, they think we're helping the little guy.
I think that that's how it's presented to people, and I think Eric's absolutely right. It's this interesting lacunae in the Tea Party platform that they never talk about farm subsidies as wasteful government spending. But in fact, it should be a target of budget cutters, and it's odd that it isn't. But again, it's about apathy. It's about people and lack of knowledge. People just, this is the farm bill. This doesn't affect me. Well, it does affect you. It affects anyone who eats. And we all have a stake in that piece of legislation. And the more of us get involved, it only survives in darkness. I mean, really. And if people start paying attention, it will change. Because it can't be supported. The standard of public health needs to be applied. I mean, every amendment, every plank in that bill must be subjected to the litmus test of, does this contribute to the public health of Americans or detract? And if we merely brought that lens to bear on that piece of legislation, it would be completely rewritten.
Okay, I want to talk about food just for a minute. Do both of you cook?
I do. Do you cook?
I boil.
What does that mean?
I'm not very good at cooking.
What is your involvement? Do you shop?
Occasionally I shop.
Oh.
I eat.
You eat. What is your current favorite dish that is prepared at
that
home?
That I can make?
Hmm?
A dish that I can make that's my
favorite?
Well,
either that you can make or
oatmeal.
Someone you love makes for you. Say this again, I miss that.
Oatmeal.
It would be oatmeal.
That's a boiling dish.
That's a good dish. Great if you care. A few apples in there, you have something delicious. But seriously, what's a what's a dish that you love, that you crave?
You're not going to get any really good response. I can make,
it doesn't
I
have
can
to
make
be.
A grilled cheese. I'm sorry, this is not my strength at all. It's my fault. I'm better at systems analysis.
Somebody has to be.
And I'm very good at doing dishes.
We need those. We need more of those. Michael?
But I think Michael is learning how
to
cook now.
Yeah, Michael's the man. Well, Michael, you're a gardener. You're a big gardener.
I am a gardener, yeah. And then that's how I got into writing about food. I mean, Eric and I came at this subject from very different directions, and it's interesting how we've converged, but Eric comes at this as an analyst of political and economic systems. I came out of this as a gardener and someone interested in nature, and realizing at a certain point that the most important engagement we have with the natural world is through our eating, and that we affected nature more through our food choices than anything else we do. And so over time, I was very interested in growing food. I've always had a big vegetable garden, and although, I mean, it's not as big as it once was, but and if you garden, you'll get interested in cooking because you'll have all this stuff that you'll have to do something with, or that zucchini will just keep growing. So I have kind of perforce learned to cook and enjoy it. I find it a very meditative, relaxing thing to do at the end of the day. And I don't know that I'm so good at it, but I find it really satisfying.
And I like people who cook.
He's an appreciative eater. I can testify
That's
to true. That. But it's a very important part of this whole thing we're talking about in these macro terms, but frankly, the food movement is only going to get so far unless people cook. Because, this, if we're really going to have a food system dedicated to growing real food, fruits and vegetables and sustainably raised meat, you're going to have to cook it yourself. And cooking is also the solution, I think, I've come to think, to the problem of how do you eat well if you don't have a lot of money. And one of the things I've been surprised to learn is that technique can make up for a lot of that problem. We have this filet culture, you know, our idea of cooking, we only have, if we're cooking, we only have 20 minutes, so we buy an expensive filet of meat or fish or whatever, a chicken breast or piece of salmon, and we put it on the grill or we do something really fast, and that's, you know, that's rich person's cooking. But there is this whole peasant tradition of using, you know, really funky cuts of meat and cooking them more slowly with a little more attention, which allows you to make delicious food, sustainably raised, even pastured, on for very, very little money.
It's the most fun.
Well, it is fun, but people are very intimidated, and the skills have been lost in a lot of our society. And you know, people say they don't have time, and they really believe they don't have time. I think we all have a panic around time, but it bears scrutiny because somehow we've found 2 hours in the day over the last 10 years to be online, and that's not at work. And so it's still a 24-hour day. So we kind of decided that was important and that cooking wasn't important. And so one of the things I think we need to do if we want to, in the interest of our health, our family's health, and building this new renaissance in local food, is we need to start cooking again.
I would like to ask each of you, you have this audience here who's hungry for knowledge. Who do you read that you think people should be reading now, either in old-fashioned media or newer media? Like, who do you follow on Twitter, if you follow interesting people on Twitter? And what sort of online aggregate sites do you enjoy, or what journalists do you think you should be following now?
On food subjects?
We can maybe broaden it a little bit. On interesting, because food is so much more than food, as you have brought to bear tonight.
Of the websites, I would say Grist, which is about food and the environment. And among food writers who are not sitting on the stage right now, I would say Raj Patel, who's in the
fabulous
Bay Area, whose work I very much admire. And then I would just urge everyone to read Wendell Berry, who had so many of these ideas so long ago, and I think really inspired Michael and I, and in my case without even knowing it, because I was just very ignorant of his work. But I would encourage people to read The Unsettling of America and Wendell Berry.
Yeah, it is amazing how much of this conversation was going on in the 70s, and we are really standing on the shoulders of people like Wendell Berry, Joan Gussow, who's not as well known, but a very important figure in this, Frances Moore LePay, who in 1971 was talking about the problem of meat and the environment. So I read those people still and interview them for their wisdom whenever I can. More contemporaries, I agree, Grist is a terrific online magazine. I strongly recommend it. Civil Eats, if you want to follow the food movement and politics, very, very good. Marion Nessel has a blog called Food Politics, and her book by that name is well worth reading for giving you a kind of a macro view of the whole system and the problems. On my website, I have links to my favorite blogs and, you know, where you can get really good information on this issue. But between Grist and Civil Eats, I think you'll pick up a whole bunch of good stuff.
And I think we would all probably agree that Mark Bittman in his new sort of
enlarged his new column
sphere
is very exciting. And just the fact that the Times saw fit to create a column on the politics of food, I think is a very good... You know, one of the peculiarities of this movement is that it won the media before it won much of anything else. And we have to go beyond that, but the Times has been very friendly to these issues, probably because there are very few large farmers in Manhattan.
I want to thank USC Visions and Voices for putting together this really fantastic program.
Thanks for listening. Be sure to subscribe to our podcast and visit us at podcasts.usc.edu. And for more programming from the USC Arts and Humanities Initiative, go to visionsandvoices.usc.edu.